This program is a Warren Steibel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line is made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Annenberg Foundation and the Friends of Firing Line.
We enter the final hour in exploring the question of prisons. What purpose do they serve other than the most obvious one, which is to keep them away from us? Have we been missing something all along the line? Governor Pete DuPont of Delaware has views on that question, as on so many others. And as much is true of Dr. John Goodman of the National Center for Policy Analysis. But our other analysts have had direct experience with prison, two of them as inmates. Charles Colson was sent to prison for committing perjury on behalf of Richard Nixon, Jean Harris for murdering her lover. If either of them had been sentenced to be executed, it is not unlikely they'd have sought the help of Professor Stephen Bright of Yale, who specializes in keeping his clients, who are here distinguished from his students, from the chair. So let's begin by asking Dr. Bright, is the case you make against capital punishment a case you're also willing to make against prisons in general?
No, there's clearly a place for prison, and there are clearly some people who belong in prisons to protect society from those people. And if the prisons weren't so hopelessly overcrowded, we could even be teaching those people and rehabilitating them, and a lot of them could be returned to the society. But a lot of the same problems that we see with capital punishment, the racism that infects the use of the death penalty, the fact that it's the great differences based upon race, those same things we see throughout the prison system. The most classic example right now is with regard to sentencing people for drugs and the fact that crack cocaine carries so much more serious penalties than powdered cocaine. And of course, African Americans are being sentenced to long prison time for crack cocaine, and that's why, although the amount of crime by African Americans has not gone up in the last few years, the number of African Americans in the prison system has gone up tremendously because of these sentencing matters. Another thing that's very consistent is that the criminal justice system, at least as it relates to poor people, and the only people that I've ever represented have been poor, so I probably would not have had either Mr. Colson or Ms. Harris. But for those people, generally, the criminal justice system is not very good at sorting out people with regard to either guilt or punishment, because the quality of justice for poor people in this country is so poor. In Atlanta, Georgia, for example, there may be 25 poor people facing serious charges. They'll all be interviewed by one public defender while they're handcuffed to each other, and a few minutes later, 15 or 17 of them will plead guilty and be sentenced on the spot. You don't have a very thoughtful approach to corrections when you have that sort of slaughterhouse justice going on. Those are not death penalty cases.
In your experience, is this an important numerical factor, the number of people who are in prison who are in fact innocent?
There are many people who are in prison who are innocent, yes, Bill,
It's an important numerical factor.
Well, the plea bargaining system, 92% of all crimes are disposed of by plea bargains. Mm-hmm. Plea bargains, automatically, the prosecutor, because I had this done to me, prosecutor comes and says, if you'll plead to this misdemeanor, whether you did it or not, I'll let you off. So an awful lot of people are in prison for a negotiated justice, and there's a lot of inequities that occur as a result of that. The number of people who are there because they didn't ever commit a crime and are genuinely innocent, you'll get a handful of those kind of cases every year that are spared from the death penalty by men like Dr. Bright, who go in and take those kind of cases, and I applaud them for doing it.
Okay, now, in terms of numbers, you think that as many as half of the people who are currently in jail could be let out of jail without endangering the lives of their neighbors or the well-being of their neighbors. Now, the selection of those 50% would exclude people who were there in the first instance for violent crime?
Well, if I were to take a state prison system, and we did this actually in Delaware when Pete DuPont was governor, and you can set up some standards whereby you look at the criminal history, you look at what they're in prison for, and you can make early release or you can put them in alternative sentencing. And you wouldn't get 50% of the prison population, but you would get maybe 25 or 30% in some states. A place like Minnesota, you wouldn't get any because they do that kind of discriminatory work before they put them in prison. They have good sentencing guidelines. And states that have good sentencing guidelines can keep the prison population down to manageable proportions. It's out of control in this state. It's out of control in California. It's now out of control pretty much in Florida, although it's coming back in with as they refine the sentencing guidelines. But you could go through and put those people in work programs. You see, the mistake we make in America is think that we equate prison and punishment. You can punish someone very severely, white collar or blue collar, without necessarily putting them in prison. I was in prison. I was in a prison dormitory with 20 guys, and they weren't white collar, they were blue collar, who had done car theft and petty stock swindling and $3,000 on this kind of a scam. And if you put those people cleaning out bedpans in the hospital or doing some public service work for 3 or 4 years, that's, and take away their weekends, that's severe punishment. You don't have to lock them up at a cost of $30,000 a year to the taxpayers. That's simply punishing us. And the danger, there's two dangers to the way we're using prisons today. Number one, we're so overcrowding the prisons that we can't do anything effective inside the prison, and we're letting dangerous people out much too early. The second thing is we're deluding ourselves into thinking that that's going to solve the problem. That's not going to solve the problem. We've got to go to the moral roots of the problem to be able to solve the crime problem in America. It's a problem of the heart.
On the practical side of it, then, why don't we go to a system of victim compensation?
I'm thoroughly in support of it and have testified in favor of it in many
states. And why are you meeting resistance?
You're meeting resistance because politicians and Pete DuPont will tell you they're under intense pressure. At Nixon's funeral, I talked to President Clinton and said the crime bill, that $22 billion crime bill, it was then $22 billion, is a waste of money. You're pouring it down the rat hole. He said, I know the cops tell me the same thing. He said, the prisons don't stop the crime. I said, that's right, they don't stop the crime. Why are you doing it? Well, the politicians, he said. I said, Mr. President, you're a politician. But then you saw him
was that news?
Come out screaming that we have to have the crime bill. Well, public pressure.
Chuck, we do need some people to stand tall.
Somebody has to stand up and say, this system is broke. The moral collapse in America is overcoming our ability to respond institutionally, and an institutional response doesn't work anyway because crime is a problem of the heart, of wrong moral choices.
Three things I think we've agreed with here. I'm not sure whether Gene agrees. One, we've agreed that violent people ought to stay in prison.
Right, yep. I agree with
secondly,
that,
we've agreed that there are a lot of people in prison who could be serving in some alternative sentence
that's
that takes
right.
their freedom away without putting them in high security prison. And thirdly, I think we've agreed that a return of a moral compass to America would begin to attack some of these problems.
Okay,
well, I think
some
around the table might dismiss that, but you're absolutely right.
Mrs.
I
Harris.
Think most people agree to that, but one thing I think you've overlooked completely is that when we're making restitution to victims, a very large percentage of people in prison were victims before they got to prison. I don't know what the percentage is, but I know it's over 10% of the women at Bedford who were raped as little children. Who have had all sorts of terror. They come in with ulcerated sores where they've been stabbed with rusty knives. They've had all kinds of victimization. That's one of the causes of crime. They begin to fight back because they're tired of being victims. You know, the one compelling thing you learn in prison is that it isn't us against them. We are all connected. And what happens to those people and what has happened to them up to the time they come to prison touches our lives. We cannot separate ourselves from them.
Well, Dr. Goodman, you never said that restitution is doable at every level.
No, but I think there are two separate issues here. One, I've never understood why we don't allow people behind prison walls to be productive. Why don't we create factories behind
because
bars?
Because the labor unions fight
it. Why don't
we
allow prisoners to earn the very most they can in a labor market which is increasingly mobile and you don't
unions
have to travel?
Unions have fought that for years.
Let Mr. Milken handle your portfolio.
So secondly, given that they are doing something productive and earning the most that they can, shouldn't a portion of that go to the victim? Shouldn't a portion of that go to
yes.
for their upkeep?
Yeah. John, and that is done in Singapore right now. Singapore has a quasi-government private commission. They put industries into the Shanghai prison, 10,000 inmates, every single one is earning 70% of the going rate on the outside because that's a productivity adjustment is made for being in prison. They pay for their room and board in the prison, they pay back their victims, they support their family, there is no welfare, and the prison system last year made $7 million. I've gone all over America saying, why don't we go do what Singapore does? Yet, and I went back to Singapore last year, and not a single American corrections official had gone over there to see it. You just cannot overcome this political lethargy. But yeah, every single inmate ought to be made to work, not only because it produces something useful, but because it does something to that individual.
That's right.
They now have a sense of self-worth. We are created in the image of God. We are made to work and be productive. You put somebody in a cell staring at the wall, you turn them into a crazy man.
There was a news story 3 or 4 days ago about three states, including Florida, I'm not sure whether it includes Texas or not, are proposing to withdraw from inmates the right to use television, and pointing to other withdrawals that have already been affected. They can't have pool, can't have pornography.
No more Pell Grants.
No more what?
Pell Grants.
No more college.
Now, does this make sense to you?
No.
Well, taking the pornography out sure does. I mean, to me, that's like throwing oil on a burning fire, or gasoline on a burning fire, to put pornography into an all-male prison.
I wish I hadn't mentioned that, because that derailed us.
But I think to take away television and to take away recreational facilities is very short-sighted. What you're doing is pandering to the worst of public prejudices. You're saying, aha, we'll show you we're getting tough with these people, we'll make them break rocks, and we forget that 97% of them are going to get back out on the street and come back out and live in our midst. And so if we want to treat them as savages while they're inside, then we can expect them to behave as savages as they
Well, in terms of deprivation, though, does it make sense to you as a penological question?
Oh, yes, and we already have that, and every prison has a segregation unit and a punishment unit, so that if someone misbehaves in the general population, they're segregated, they're put away, they get no television, they're locked up for 30 days. Very harsh punishment within the prison. But to do that to the entire prison, I'll tell you, if we start doing that to the prisons, I wouldn't want to work as a prison guard.
What if you were to read recordings to the whole prison of great books?
Great books?
Yeah.
I'd just like to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in the prisons, because I've seen how that's changed people's lives. And I will tell you, nothing else does like the
greatest.
Might there be a
that is the greatest. Greatest.
Yeah. But where was I read the other day? Someplace they couldn't get any quiet from these teenagers, and so they finally turned on some Mozart, and that drove them all away. That was one punishment they couldn't stand.
Chuck, let me come back to something you said about the fact that they're earning within these factories, within walls, and they get a feeling of self-respect and so forth. Wouldn't that same thing apply to women on welfare? That if they were earning that check instead of just receiving it, that they would begin to have that sense of being part of community.
Yes, of course.
It seems to me we could apply it there as well.
Well, you apply it to everyone. I mean, the work ethic is a terribly important element in the building of our own character, and we're made that way. We're created to be doing something useful. It is inhumane to send someone a check for aid for families with dependent children for $365 a month to sit home and do nothing, because we're not made to be that way. So that the work component in all of this is very much related to the crime component. But the fact of the matter is that the work does something in the prison that is really important. I don't believe in rehabilitation. I mean, the liberals in the 30s and 40s said, we'll put people away, we'll re-socialize them in the prisons. And we built all of these dormitory-style prisons to take people out of their terrible environments and improve them in the prisons. Well, they came out much worse than they went in. And that's why we have the legacy of one of the largest prison populations in the world. Along came the conservatives and said, we'll scare them out of prisons, scare them out of crime. That doesn't work either. But you can, when you get them in that prison, make them work, and you can respect their dignity. I was just in a prison in Brazil last week that we own, one of the most amazing places I've ever been in my life. It's run by Christians. The chapel is the center of that program. When that inmate comes, he's got handcuffs on. The guard removes the handcuffs, the guard is an inmate, and says, in this prison, you are not restrained by steel, you are constrained by the love of Christ. He gets a buddy assigned to him immediately. He either has to go to character classes or to chapel. 95% choose the chapel. A volunteer family works with him. And over 20 years, with 7,000 inmates, we've had a 4% recidivism rate. It works. I was there last week. It was like being in a spiritual retreat center. I didn't want to leave.
Would that be constitutional in the United States?
I don't know.
Could we do that here?
The federal courts would allow.
Yeah, there's a very good friend of mine who spent a lot of money, Jack Eckerd, a very wonderful, public-spirited citizen. You know him well, Pete. And he spent a lot of money to try to duplicate that Humida experience back here and discovered that Alvin Bronstein, who makes some sense on some of the things he says about prisons, would be into court and stop you immediately. He couldn't do it under our present legal system in America, but it's a tragedy. Other countries are adopting it, trying it, and it's working.
What if we go to private prisons?
I thought we had the show. You had a show on separation of church and state a couple of weeks ago. Could I go back to prisons for just a minute to talk about one thing, as much as I admire all these things that have been said, which is this. You know, these programs where people earn are not totally unheard of in the United States. I agree with the three points that you made about locking up violent people, having more alternatives, which we have so few of in this country, and the lack of a moral compass. What troubles me immensely is I think where we see that lack of a moral compass most pronounced in this country is in the debate and the demagoguery on the crime issue. I mean, we have right now a grandmother serving time in Georgia who killed her husband, who had abused her for years, and finally he came after her. She's been locked up for a long time. She's been working. She's even paid part of the costs of her housing there at the prison. And she was just about to be paroled, but we've got a governor's election now in Georgia where everybody is running on who can be for abolishing parole, who can be. We're for two strikes you're out in Georgia, not three strikes you're out. And as a result, she's been postponed way into the next century in terms of being released. This is just sheer failure of anybody to stand up and say, this isn't right, it's not working, some of these things we're doing with regard to crime. And the most classic example, if I could just finish, Bill, is the crime debate in the Congress that just took place, and the 60 death penalties and the three strikes you're out, and nobody standing up and saying, this just simply isn't doing anything to make the streets safer and to do something about the problem of crime in our society.
I heard him.
Well, I think he attacked it from the standpoint that it wasn't enough. I mean, I know Gingrich and these people say we need even more death penalties than the 60 that were just passed.
I don't think to individualize a problem by pointing to a grandmother in this situation is going to shed much light on
several
institutional problems. If you're going to say, can we as a free society itemize the abuses of freedom, the answer is yes. Very easy to do, fill the room full of examples. But we're talking about institutional reforms, and Governor DuPont a while ago was saying what we need to do is attract people to the preference of truth over untruth. And that gets done at an early age. And your question was, why is there so much consolidated objection to people having the freedom of access to schools, even if they can't afford the kind of salary that currently being asked of people in private schools?
I didn't put it nearly so eloquently, of course.
Steve,
but the question is, if there are places that would instill this sense of truth versus untruth, of virtue versus malevolence or lack of virtue, our society walls a lot of low-income people out of that because it doesn't allow them to take the resources the state's willing to spend for their education and use those resources in such a school. And it seems to me that's something you need to get rid of.
Society's even doing worse than that. It's subsidizing illegitimacy. And until we go back to restoring the family in American life, we are headed for a police state in this country because people, if it gets much worse, if the streets get much more dangerous, 56% of the black inner-city males in the city of Baltimore are either in prison, in jail, awaiting trial, or on probation. Now, when that breaks down, and there are five women for every eligible adult black male in many of the inner city areas today. And so the family structure has been stripped away by subsidizing illegitimacy with a welfare system that has just gone amok.
We need to subsidize the
kids aren't trying to deal with. And when they get to be 18, 19, and 20, they're feral children. They have no conscience. Nothing has ever
they are
cultivated
feral
the habits
children,
of the heart,
and it starts
which have
very
to come
early.
From the family, from
feral
community, from church, from inner city resources, and from a cleaning up of popular culture. When we do that, then we'll get serious about crime
but
in America.
Somebody has to object here for a minute. The fact is, to say that our welfare system is providing the money for illegitimacy is really a terrible overstatement. That the statistic that the government gives us is that a welfare check today is worth 40% less than it was in 1970. In the city of New York, though we scream about the welfare payments there, we spend over $400 million on Medicaid because these people are so sickly all the time. They don't do any preventive medicine. $400 million on Medicaid and about $200 million on welfare, and there are 6% more people on it than were on a couple of years ago. So anybody can tell you that when they get their welfare check, they are still $5,000 below the poverty level for a family of three. Now, you yourself have said most of us are rational. No rational person would strive to live on $5,000 below the poverty level. They do it out of desperation. They don't do it because that's the way to pay for having more kids. That may have been true, and I don't even think it was then, 25 years ago. But the fact is, these women, the women on welfare that I know, and I know a lot of them, aren't cheating any more than the local grocer who's buying their food stamps for 50 cents on the dollar and turning them in for a dollar. These people live in a society where everybody cheats them, where the police in Harlem and the 30th Precinct Police Station they've found 14 of them that have been selling drugs themselves while they were arresting these people and putting them in prison. Their life
but
is
do you
not
agree,
the ball of cherries
you
people
agree the
think
whole welfare state is designed to get people to give up one culture and accept another one?
No, I don't.
Completely change.
I think they do it in desperation.
The welfare system is designed to keep those women there. The tax laws are such, if they try to work their way off, they can't do it. The marginal tax rates are close to 100%.
Pete,
the
best thing in the world would be what you suggested, to have these women go out and get a good job. Who do you suggest should take care of their children while they're out with that good job? Right now, we have nothing to offer
them. The same people that take care of the children of women who are not on welfare, who are working today?
Yeah, they're spending a great
percentage of their income. Isn't it?
But let me give you a practical example. In Delaware, we underwent a huge deregulation program back in 1981 that brought thousands of new jobs into the state. The AFDC case rate, without doing any change, making any change whatsoever to the welfare system, the number of women on AFDC in Delaware dropped 40%. They went to work. Nobody did anything for them that was different than we were doing before. They saw the job. The jobs were available to them, and that may be different, was different than before, but they went to work. They provided their transportation. They took care of their daycare. They were very smart women. They did have a conscience. They understood right from wrong. Given the chance to get off of welfare, they went, and the daycare and the transportation and everything else followed right along. So it can be done.
Well, if it would cost more to provide that kind of welfare system, a system where everybody was provided a job and went to work, but it cost more initially to set that up, which is what everybody says, are you for it?
I am for it.
Are you saying you're for it and you'll get the Republican Party on board for it?
But it wouldn't cost more. I believe it could be done very easily.
And
the question is,
Stephen,
would you be for requiring someone to work in order to get a check?
I think it's all I've done for the last 20 years, represent poor people. There's no question. Most of my clients are absolutely desperate people. If you could give them any opportunity to do something worthwhile, to make a living, they would take advantage of it. Unfortunately, what I think you don't factor in is that many of these people are, as Gene has described, people who literally were abused and disabled before they were ever born due to their mother's ingestion of alcohol or drugs. They're operating on an IQ of 65 or 70. They don't have the same ability that you and I have to function. But even with those, and they don't have particularly good judgment a lot of times, and they don't really understand rewards and punishment and those kind of things. But if they had the opportunity to do anything, I mean, some of them we put to work just making Xerox copies or whatever, or just laundering clothes all day long, they would take advantage of it. Well, but it seems to me that as I look at what's talked about on welfare reform, it's just like the politics of crime. There's a lot of demagoguery and there's a lot of pontificating, but nobody wants to step up to the plate and really come forward with a program that will put people to work and will pay the cost that having a Job Corps program for everybody in this country and putting people to work.
No, I disagree with Chuck. Not a Job Corps program. Real work.
Some kind of program. No, I'm talking about a program, though, like in the prisons,
Governor,
for example.
Express your reservations.
I think we've made one enormous step here, I can say this to Mr. Buckley, that we've gotten the Yale group to agree. that there ought to be work instead of welfare the deconstruction is an extraordinary piece of progress. There are such programs.
I'm very anxious to say this as a matter of the record. We've been talking almost necessarily from time to time about extreme cases. The 13-year-old mother who was abused when she was three, that kind of thing. But that's not what you're talking about, is it?
No.
You're talking about people that you can speak to whose IQ isn't as low as 65, with whom you can communicate something about the balance of life.
Well, you can prove anything you want in this anecdotally by finding examples and extreme examples in all directions. What's fundamentally flawed, Bill, is that we are trying to provide an institutional response to a moral problem. And we're overusing the institution of prison so that you're sweeping up a lot of guys. I mean, I ran the laundry in the Maxwell Federal Prison. I ran the washing machine next to the fellow running the dryer who was the former chairman of the board of the American Medical Association. I mean, some days we switched for variety, and I would do the dryer and he'd do the washer. But the fact of the matter is that he wasn't allowed to practice medicine, and yet there was a shortage of obstetricians in Montgomery, Alabama, where that prison was located. Now, this is nuts. Put the fellow to work. And if you went through the federal prisons tomorrow...
Were you allowed to practice law?
No, I wasn't. I did help a lot of the inmates at night, but I was not allowed to use my profession. But you could go through the federal prisons tomorrow, and the retired head of the Federal Bureau of Prisons, Mike Quinlan, told me, you take 20% of those people out of there just like that and put them to work. So that we can make some structural changes that will help and give us more space and then deal with the root problem.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Governor. Thank you, Ms. Harris.
Good.
Next week on Firing Line, host William F. Buckley Jr. is joined by Bard College President Leon Botstein, ACLU Executive Director Ira Glasser, Professor Walter Burns, and attorneys Brian Stevenson, Stephen Bright, Susan Bolin, and Ed Koch for part one of The Death Penalty. This program was a Warren Stiebel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line was made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support was provided by the Annenberg Foundation and the Friends of Firing Line. For information about a video cassette of this program, write to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205, or call 803-799-3449. That's Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205, or call 803-799-3449.